ॐ विश्वं दर्पणदृश्यमाननगरी तुल्यन्निजान्तर्गतं पश्यन्नात्मनि मायया बहिरिवोद्भूतं यथा निद्रया यस्साक्षात्कुरुते प्रबोधसमये स्वात्मानमेवाद्वयं तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये बीजस्यान्तरिमाङ्कुरो जगदिदं प्राङ्निर्विकल्पं पुनः मायाकल्पितदेशकालकलना वैचित्र्यचित्रीकृतं मायावीव विजृम्भयत्यभिमहायोगी वयस्वेच्छया तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः सो वर्स 54 अर्जुन उवाच स्थितप्रज्ञस्य का भाषा समाधिस्थस्य केशव सितदिः किं प्रभाषेत किमासीत व्रजेत किम् ओ केशव सो ओ केशव हे कृष्णा सो भगवान इज कॉल्ड केशव बिकॉज ही किल्ड ए डेमन कॉल्ड केशी देयरफॉर सो ही किल्ड ए डेमन कॉल्ड केशी हिज दैट्स हाउ हिज अनदर नेम ऑल्सो इज देयर केशी निषूदन केशिम निषूदयति इति केशी निषूदन निषूदयति मीन्स किल्स And so his another name. So two names are there for Bhagavan, Keshava or Keshi Nishudana. So because he killed a demon called Keshi. So O Keshava, Stita Prajnasya ka bhasha, Stita Prajnasya. Well, one in whom this Atma Jnanam is very firm. Samadhisthasya, another synonym for Stita Prajna, Samadhisthasya. So for of one whose mind abides in the self, bhasha. So sthita prajnasya ka bhasha. So what is the description? Ka means what? And the bhasha means bhashyate iti bhasha. So description. Sthita dihi, a third synonym. In a single word, three synonyms are there for the wise person. Sthita prajna. Samadhistha sthitadihi. Same thing. Anyway, sthitadihi, one whose mind is not shaken by anything. Kim prabhasheta. Well, how he would how does he speak? Then kim asit, how would he sit? Kim vrajet, how would he walk? This is how the question is. Means, how does such a person whose mind is not shaken by anything speak, sit or walk? So Bhashyakara introduces this section is called Sitapragna Lakshanam. Sitapragna Lakshanam. Lakshanani, you can even say. Lakshanani. Lakshanam means characteristic. The characteristic of a wise man. That's all. This is whole section is called this. So Bhashyakara introduced this verse by saying that Arjuna, desiring to know the characteristic of this wise person or a characteristic of a person who knows the Atma, ask this question. How does a person speak? How does he sit? How does he walk? How does he talk? Etc. etc. So word Sitapragna refers to, well, first we should see what is that word Sitapragna. So in Sanskritam, of course, is Sthita Prajna Yasya Saha. It is Sthita Prajna. Sthita Prajna. So Sthita means here, basically, whose knowledge. Prajna means Atma Jnanam, basically, which is born of the discrimination between Atma and Anatma. So such a knowledge is free from doubt and error. We drop the word vagueness, which we were using earlier. We drop that word vagueness because in my mind there is vagueness regarding the word vagueness, and therefore I am dropping this word now. So, but doubt and error. So, well, so who has no doubt, who has no error now with reference to the knowledge of Atma, such a person is called Sthita Prajna. So the knowledge stays. Sthitam means actually sthadhatu means to stand, to stay. So sthitam means sthitam sthita prajna means knowledge stays. Prajna means knowledge. Sthita means stays. So the knowledge stays in a person. That person is called sthita prajna. So a person's knowledge, of course, he's free from the doubt because of a long shravanam and mananam. Well, it becomes free. But then, definitely, as I told you, these vasanas are there. So even though, now he has understood very well that he is not a deha, etc., he's not a mind, but still that vasana. Vasana means that I have told you, the smell, good or bad, continues even after the object leaves. That's called vasana. So the word vasaha means a smell. Vasanam also is a smell. So that is they have made a feminine noun, vasana. Anyway, so that even after he gains this knowledge, clear knowledge, and now even still that vasanas are there, dehatma vasana, because if you keep an object in any object which has some smell, good or bad, if you keep it in a particular container for a long time, then definitely even if you remove the object, this smell continues. Same way, now he has got a clarity in this knowledge, well, but still because of this dehatma vasana, so the error will occur. Error can occur. I am deha, such error can occur. I am mind. There is a happiness outside in the object. Such kind of thing can occur. Don't think this kind of thing will not occur. It occurs out of habit. So it's an error. So definitely after a nididhyasanam, this will go. One has to do the nididhyasanam. It is required. So then if the knowledge will be sthitam. Knowledge now stays. Free from doubt and error. One person in whom this knowledge regarding the self stays. That such person is called Sthita Prajna. We call wise man. Anyway, and Sthita Prajna. So, because the word is a masculine. Sthita Prajna, Ramasya, Sthita Prajnasya. So, here that itself indicates Sthita Prajna word being a masculine word, it indicates a person. Because if it is a knowledge, it would be prajna, right? And it will be feminine now. But it is not a feminine noun. They have, instead of prajna, they have made prajna. So indicates a masculine noun. And therefore, this sthita prajna is not indicating a knowledge. It is indicating a person in whom this knowledge is there, such a knowledge. So this we should be clear about it. Prajna is a feminine gender. Prajna is a masculine gender. Therefore, definitely in Bahuri, this kind of thing will occur. This is in compound. Well, prajna can mean knowledge of course, anything. Even in the knowledge of, engineering, etc. also. But Bhashyakara clarifies this. The knowledge, here it is what is being spoke, told about, is that knowledge is Param Brahma Aham Asmi. So, topic here is Paramatma, not an engineering. And so, the person for whom the knowledge of Atma being Param Brahma is steady, such a person is called Sthita Prajna. And now another word is used. Samadhisthasya, Sthita Prajnasya, Samadhisthasya. So both Shashti indicating, denoting the same person. And so another word, synonymous word for Sthita Prajna. Samadhisthasya, Samadau Tishthati, Iti Samadhisthah, Tasya. Kute Tishthati, Kutasthah, Tate Tishthati, Tatasthah. Like that. Samadhau tishthati iti samadhistha. So one whose mind is abiding in samadhi. What is one whose mind is abiding in atma? We have already given the meaning of the word samadhi as atma in the just previous verse. In verse 53 already it has come. Samadhau na vidhiyate, etc. Except I will tell you that, we have seen that verse in which Samadhau achala buddhihi, tada yogam avapsasi, etc. Samadhau means an atma, this buddhi means the jnanam regarding the atma is achala, nishala, etc. We have seen that. And so here also the same thing. Because Arjuna knows Bhagavan has used this word and so he picked up that word. For atma, Bhagavan has used word samadhi in the previous verse. So now asking the question, Arjuna definitely is taking up this. So, Arjuna asks, this is, and we should remember this Arjuna's first question after Bhagavan started teaching. Bhagavan started teaching in verse 11. After that, regarding the teaching, this is the first question. There are going to follow so many questions in third chapter and other places. Anyway, so samadhi sasya means whose mind, of course, is abiding in atma. Samadhu tishtati means he is abiding in atma. He is awake to atma. One who is awake to atma, one who is aware of himself totally as it is called samadhau tishtati samadhistha. Means I am full, complete, etc. I am asangaha, I am limitless, etc. He is very much clear about it. Now no more error also. So Arjuna wanted to know how Krishna would describe such a person. Sita prajnasya ka bhasha. So he asked Bhagavan, Sita Prajnasya Ka Bhasha, what is the description of this wise person? Bhasha, I have already told you, Bhashyate Iti Bhasha, description. Of course, Bhashyakara puts it a little differently. Bhashyakara says, Katham Asau Paraihi Bhashyate. Katham Asau Paraihi Anyaihi. How is this person described by others? Please tell me. One way of looking at it, Arjuna is directly asking Bhagavan that how would you describe this Jnani? Bhashyakara says, how is this person described by Paraihi, Anyaihi? How is this person described by other people? So that he wants to know from Bhagavan. And Bhagavan has used the word samadhi, of course, in the previous verse, as I told you, not sthita prajna, etc. Anyway, and so he asked for a description. Arjuna is asking for a description of a wise person, a sthita prajna. Very excellent question. That's how the whole section is there. And then a third synonymous word also is here, he has used sthita dihi. Dhi means, you know, buddhi. So, sthita dhihi, sthita dhihi yasya saha sthita dhihi. So, if a person whose buddhi remains firm, sthita. Firm in what? Firm in knowledge. Knowledge of what? Knowledge of Brahman. Knowledge of Brahman or knowledge of Atma? Knowledge of Brahman, which is nothing but Atma. Brahman is Atma. That's how his buddhi is now firm, it is very firm in that. Like it's simple to understand, you know, like our buddhi is very firm right now, without doubt and error. Aham manushyah, so firmly established we are. Without even, that's how they in Gujarati also they used to say, even the person you know, gets up from the bed and if you ask, who are you? Without thinking, he will answer immediately, I am so and so. He may tell you the name, but that name indicates that he denotes a body. Anyway, because the name is given to the body, name is not given to the Atma. A body is given a particular name. Like Muktatma is name not of Atma as such. Even the word Atma is there, but the Muktatma name is given to this body. Anyway, what I am saying is, how we clear we are. There is no doubt, no error. I mean, in whatever condition we are, and we are able to tell very spontaneously that I am Deha. That's all. Same way he says, I am Brahman. In our awareness, I am awakened to myself that I am Deha. This person is awakened to himself that he is nothing other than Brahman. He is just consciousness. Plain consciousness. Plain consciousness. Shuddha. So, you know, pure consciousness. Pure. This Pujasam is what I am using. Pure consciousness. Pure consciousness. Why Pujasamaji explains that? Because all the time mixed up. One says that I am a conscious being. When he says that, definitely some upadhi is mixed up. And therefore, free from any upadhi. Upadhi vinirmuktam chaitanyam brahma ahamasmi. All the time, very clear. His person is sthita prajna or sthita dihi, let's say that. Anyway, but then he asked what? Arjuna asked, kim prabhasheta, does this person talk? Kim asita, does he or she sit? Kim vrajeta, does he or she walk? Vrajdhatu is in terms of gachati. Vrajati, grachati. So, Bhashyakara did not think that, you know, these questions are as worded in these words are Arjuna's real question. Why? Bhashyakara explains that later. He says, to ask, does a wise person talk? If really Arjuna has this kind of a question, and he asked to Bhagavan also that, then, it shows what? Whether he talks or not, such kind of question, if you ask, means what? Bhagavan is keep on talking since long. And therefore, in Arjuna's mind, there should be a doubt that whether the Bhagavan, whatever he is talking regarding Atma, whether he knows it or not, whether he is a wise person or not. Because he keeps on talking. Bhagavan keeps on talking. Now he stopped. At the verse 53 is over, there he stopped. So such, if Bhagavan is a wise person, then definitely Arjuna would not ask this question, because being a wise person also, Bhagavan keeps talking. Still Arjuna is asking this question. Does a wise person talk? He means something else. Definitely. Not just talking kind of. Because Krishna had been talking all along. And so, and therefore here, kim, the word kim is there. It has a meaning, of course it's for question only. So, kim means what? Or kim means how? So, Bhashyakara says, well, Bhashyakara took Arjuna's questions, you know, to mean kim is equal to how. I mean, whether the wise person talks or not is not a question, because Bhagavan keeps talking, and in Arjuna's eye, definitely Bhagavan is a wise person, definitely. Because what he is talking about is all giving a wisdom. He was giving a wisdom. And therefore, he was giving a wisdom, but he is not established in wisdom. Such kind of a doubt will not be there in Arjuna's mind. And therefore, definitely, we should not take that way, whether he talks or not, etc. We should take it, how does he talk? What does he talk also is not a good question. How does he talk? So, Kim, the word Kim, in Sanskritam, is used for akshepa also. And he is used for asking the question also. So, he says here, Kim Prabhasheta. Kim Prabhasheta has a two translations. This Sanskritam, if you translate it, will be like this. Does he or she talk or not? That's another first question. And the answer would be yes or no. Right? So, for us, for getting an answer in yes or no, you ask this question. Kim. You start with Kim. Or else, Kim means what? What does he talk? Kim Prabhasheta, what does he talk? Or how does he talk? Bhashyakara takes that later meaning. How does he talk? That's all it means. How does he talk? So, and then of course it has been explained that when someone, asks you a question, you either answer the question or you answer the person. And when you answer the person, but still you are answering a question, but it's the spirit of the question that you address, and therefore, so when you answer the person, definitely you consider what is the intention, what is the intention of the person, or what is the person had in mind while asking the question. And definitely, because before asking a question, a person had a sense to convey through the question. And therefore, he starts asking a question. And therefore, the one who is going to answer, that listener, tries to understand the intention or the sense of the person who is, or sense of the person who is asking a question. And that is very important. So, rather than just answering the question, you should understand the spirit of the person. Or you should understand what the person had in mind behind the question and then answer the question. And that's how Bhagavan is going to answer these questions in a manner, considering the spirit behind the question of, spirit of the Arjuna behind his question. And so this is very important. Otherwise it is simply, how does he talk, whether he talks or not, whether he walks or not, etc. It doesn't make any sense, because Arjuna could not have such kind of a doubt, because the person may speak something, and therefore, the wise person speaks or not, that kind of a question cannot be there, because he definitely is gaining the wisdom from the Bhagavan, and definitely must be considering him, Bhagavan, as wise person, and Bhagavan was kept on talking. So, Bhagavan understood the spirit behind the Arjuna's question and answering the question in the that fashion. Anyway, so what Lord Krishna, of course, answered Arjuna. So when Lord Krishna, of course, answered Arjuna, he did not answer his question. He answered the person, and we'll see that. We'll relate with the question and the answer. So if Krishna had answered the question, what could he have said? Suppose he has just taken the question without understanding the Arjuna's spirit. Then definitely he would have described the Siddha Prajna as, one who walks very slowly, talks very slowly, etc., etc. You should tell all this, where the movement of the limbs become very slow. That is considered the wise man by the people generally. Even you should not, turn your head also so fast. Otherwise you will be otherwise. So you should slowly turn your face like this. And lifting the hand also slowly. Suppose if you are drinking, a wise person is drinking a coffee, he should lift it very slowly. Talking also very slowly. Because basically the words are coming from very, very, from the depth. And therefore it takes time to come. And therefore he should definitely, and people become full. people definitely become fooled by this. They always say, and that you know, when person does this kind of a thing, people think he is a wise person anyway. And so, and there are intervals. There are intervals between one word and the second word. There is an exact interval, a 1 minute interval or 2 minutes interval or half minute interval, and slowly the words come out. And they say also that it will take time because it is coming from the infinity. And therefore, basically, because he is infinite, right? And so anything which comes from the infinity will take time. And therefore, the person who is going to talk also, the wise, so-called wise person, also has this clarity. And the one who comes to have a darshan of him also has this clarity. And both have this clarity. So people can be very easily fooled by those who pose as wise by saying very little or speaking very leisurely, talking leisurely, walking leisurely, everything leisurely. Even the eye movement also should be very, very. They practice. Such people in India, they practice. You should not have the moment of eye fast. You are otherwise. So you should stare at the person and slowly close the eyes, then open. I am not able to describe. Pujya Swami used to make all this description. Don't expect from me. But these things he used to narrate in a way, really making a drama. Anyway, So Arjuna's question is not like this, whether he talks or not, or whether he walks or not, etc., etc. So then what is the spirit? What is the spirit? The spirit is, how does he or she talk and go about in the world? I mean, how does a wise person interact with the world? That's most important thing. This, all the three questions I am putting in one line. How does a person interact with the world? Walking, talking, everything, all this, we should put like this. Kim prabhasheta, kim asita, kim vrajeta. How does he sit? How does he walk? How does he talk? Well, how does he interact with the world? And so, how does he or she talk and go about in the world? Is there an indication that this person has a wisdom? Is there anything, well, that reveals the wisdom he or she has? Will there be any difference between how this person interact with the world and how an ordinary person interact with the world? Is there a difference or not? There should be a difference, definitely. How you interact with the world will reveal whether you are wise or otherwise. That's all. And whole section is going to focus on that. The interaction of an ordinary person and the interaction of a wise person in the world is different. Different. Definitely different. And that whole thing is indicated by all the three questions. Kim asita, kim vrajeta, kim prabhasheta. So, what is the characteristic of ultimately the person's wisdom? This was the spirit of Arjuna's question. And that Bhagavan is going to reply, he is going to answer the questions, but he is going to keep in the mind Arjuna's spirit behind this question. And well, that will be followed now. That will be followed. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Prajahati Yada Kamahan Sarvan Parthamanogatan Atmanyevatmana Tushtaha Sita Prajnyasta Dochyate. So Bhagavan is replying, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Lord said, what? O Partha, hey Arjuna, Yada, see you will find here Yada Tada, Tada Uchyate. So Yada goes up to the end almost. The two definitions of Sthita Prajna Bhagavan is giving here, both are connected to Yada. Yada, when? Sarvan manogatan kaman prajahati. This is one definition. When all, sarvan manogatan kaman, when all the desires which appear in the mind, prajahati gives up, is a siddha prajna. One definition. Second definition. आत्मनि एव आत्मना तुष्टः स्थितप्रज्ञः. सो आत्मनि इन वन सेल्फ, एव अलोन, आत्मना विथ वन सेल्फ, तुष्टः इन. सो ही इज हैप्पी, आई मीन ही इज हैप्पी इन वन सेल्फ, विथ वन सेल्फ, अलोन, मीन ही डजंट नीड एनी ऑब्जेक्ट इन ऑर्डर टू बी हैप्पी एक्सेट्रा. सच अ पर्सन ऑल्सो इज कॉल्ड स्थितप्रज्ञः. Siddhaprajna means a person who has a clear knowledge. Regarding what? Regarding Atma. Uchyate. So Siddhaprajna tada uchyate. When these things are there, means when a person gives up all desire as they appear in the mind, one. And when he is happy in oneself, with oneself, then that person is said to be one who is called Siddhaprajna. Who is a wise person. So two definitions are there. Atmani eva atmana tushtaha and prajaha yada kaman sarvan, yada sarvan manogatan kaman prajahati. So characteristics stated here of a wise person and in the subsequent verse as well with reference to this person who has already gained this knowledge. Now the characteristic of a wise person is not important to the wise person. And therefore, well, definitely this description is not going to be helpful to a wise person. Then this characteristic of a wise person, the lakshana of a wise person, is basically helpful to the person who is in the path of becoming wise. In the Adhyatma Shastra, they say this. What they say is the spontaneous expression of a person who is accomplished, who is siddha, who is wise, becomes the norm for the seeker. I once again say that the spontaneous expression of the person who is wise becomes the norm for the seeker. This is the rule in this Adhyatma Shastra. Anyway, so here definitely all this description will be useful to the person, the seeker who is seeking the Atma Jnanam, self-knowledge. For him this is going to be helpful. So although Arjuna only wanted to know who is Siddhaprajna, and the sadhana which is taught here, because throughout the Shastra the characteristic of a wise person are also said to be the means for preparing one's mind for the knowledge of Atma. So Bhashyakara referred to Siddhaprajna as one who is accomplished, siddha. Actually in this kind of a word we used in this Adhyatma Shastra is a Siddha Purusha. Siddha Purusha means a person who is accomplished. The seeker is called Sadhaka. And what he does, the means he employs in order to become Siddha, in order to become accomplished. But here we should understand accomplished means here Siddha Purusha means some kind of some esoteric thing, nothing of that sort. Yes, Siddha Purusha, one who is accomplished, means one who is having a clarity regarding the self. No doubt, no error. Whose mind is abided in the self. True self. Yeah, true self. So, Shankara referred Bhashyakara referred to Siddhaprajna as one who is accomplished and who has made it. Is Krutartha. Bhashyakara uses this word. Krutartha means Siddha, accomplished. And the characteristic of this person, is very, very essential for the seeker and to gain the knowledge. So the wise person's spontaneous expression in life, his attitude, his disposition with which he or she interacts with the others are the characteristic that establish the norms to be followed by the seeker of the wisdom, seeker of the knowledge. And these characteristics are to be cultivated, definitely, because they are the means by which the seeker becomes a wise person. This is like one who joins a dancing class. definitely, if suppose a dancer gives a lesson, theoretical lesson, that suppose she joins, she wants to learn Bharatanatyam, and she has joined the class, coaching classes, and then the dancer initially may give some theoretical portion. What is Bharatanatyam and how where it is, where it originated, and what are the forms and these and that and everything. If she keeps on learning this, she will never, this the girl will never be able to learn this dancing. What she has to do, you know, she has to imitate the dancer. That's all. She has to imitate the dancer. If she wants to be the dancer, she has to imitate the dancer. Same way in a singing also. Same way. What theoretical knowledge about the Carnatic music or Hindustani will not make you a musician. You have to imitate the musician. The way he says, you have to do that. I don't know. But you will have to imitate. Exactly here. If you want to be Sthita Prajna, what is going to be described now, please imitate. That's all. You imitate. Then you yourself will come to know that, I am also becoming now Sthita Prajna. Really. This is the way. We'll see what is to be imitated. So, definitely you need a lot of effort, of course, and that's that is called sadhana anushthana. There is a word, people generally use word sadhana. There is no word called sadhana. This sadhana means for gaining this knowledge, means for becoming a accomplished person, means for becoming a sthita prajna, etc. Anyway, so with this characteristic have to be cultivated carefully. I mean, whatever we are going to discuss now. And who has to cultivate this? Seeker has to cultivate. For what? To become a wise person, to become a sthita prajna. So without this kind of a means, of course, a person does not become wise. In the beginning, this will be, you will imitate, and there will be, effort in order to employ the means in your life. And later, the same sadhanam becomes an expression. Becomes an expression. It becomes your second nature. It becomes spontaneous. Like, sympathy, love, freedom, giving, so many things are going to be discussed in this, etc. They are sadhanam in the beginning. So, they are means for basically self-purification and maturity, eventually becoming the natural expression of the same person. So, it is not that the person tries to be sympathetic, loving and giving. One is naturally sympathetic, loving and giving later. But however, for the person who has not yet made it, who is not really Sthita Prajna, he has to make an effort. So make an effort for what? He has to sympathize. We have to tell like this. This person, I should have a sympathy. I cannot tell to a wise person like that. That's his natural expression. But for me, I have to give, I have to contribute, I have to have a sympathy, I have to love the people, etc. Could you follow? These are the sadhanam for us. And later, they are going to be a natural outcome or natural expression or a spontaneous expression in our life. So, initial, this is called imitation. But imitation means with understanding. Understand that, it's very clear. So there also they teach in music and all that. That's how they teach initially a portion. Theoretically they teach. So not simply say this you do keep on doing. They know what these mudras are in a dancing also. So that's how they teach a theoretical portion. But afterwards she has to imitate a teacher, dancing teacher or music teacher. So the person, the seeker, of course, has to make an effort to give, to sympathize, to love, to contribute, etc. And this is necessary because along with this thought of giving or thought of sympathy or etc., there is also a opposite thought arising in that person, in the seeker, that a reluctance to give, and or there is a tendency to hate. This thing is going to occur in the seeker. And therefore, he has been told that put your effort in order to give, in order to love, in order to have a sympathy, in order to contribute, etc., etc. And then, because in the mind of the person, well, it will arise, immediately arise, that why should I give? Immediately this thing will arise. And definitely, because if ego is there and, you know, and it is telling all the time not to give, etc. So therefore, initially with the effort, you have to do, you have to employ this as a means. What are the things to be employed as a means? What we are going to discuss? What are you going to discuss? The characteristic of a wise person, you should employ in your life with lot of effort. You have to as though imitate. But of course, all this we have discussed, that you know the fullness, love is the expression of fullness. Yesterday itself, I think we have discussed. So, forgiveness is an expression of fullness. So, for a jnani, because he is full and complete, he has abided in knowledge. So, for him, it is a spontaneous expression. Forgiveness, etc., compassion, loving, etc., is all is a form. But the person who has not yet made it, well, definitely, then he has to. And therefore, the opposite thoughts will be there. So, he has to definitely overcome the opposite thought. And we should have this consideration, love, giving, sympathy, etc. And so, these are the, for a wise person, what we are going to discuss, the characteristic, they are just a spontaneous expression, which becomes the means for the person who wants to be sthita prajna. So, that is the reason, because of this reason, it has been discussed. There is a second reason also. I told you yesterday, I will tell you why this discussion is there. Second reason is this lakshanas of a wise person provides you an incentive. That in his interaction with the world is there, he is there, but one thing is not there. What? Conflict is not there. Whereas in our life, in interaction with the world, I am there and in world is there. But there is a constant conflict. There is a constant conflict. And I mean conflict by which you can understand there is a sorrow and there is anxiety and there is a fear and what not. And there is anger and everything. And so the description will tell how, if you also become a wise, if you become a Siddha Prajna, definitely your life also will be like his life. And therefore, such description should be there by which it will provide you an incentive. You will be definitely encouraged to pursue the knowledge and ultimately become a wise person. Because you also want a life without conflict, without anxiety, without anger, without etc. And all this also you want, sympathy also you want, you want to love others, but you cannot love, you feel so. You cannot love, you cannot have a sympathy, you want to give, but somehow you cannot be able to give. So all these things will become natural expression, that which you like. And therefore, the wise person's life, if you look at it through his characteristic, well, then you will also feel, you also should have that kind of a life. And so that provides an incentive for the person who is a mumukshu, who is a seeker. So, this sadhana or the means, etc., itself is to be accomplished through, as I told you, through the effort. And if you succeed in acquiring this characteristic, then you become firmly established in the knowledge. In fact, the lakshanas which have been given there, if you basically put effort and if you cultivate that, you feel that you are going nearer to Siddha Prajna. You are going nearer to this abiding in the self. And therefore, this takes you automatically towards it automatically makes you a wise person. If you definitely cultivate those things which are going to be discussed. So you gain a jnana nishtha also. So what was accomplished through the with the effort becomes the natural expression later in the same person. That's a rule. And therefore, all universal values, etc., being natural to Siddha Prajna are the sadhanam or means for a seeker, moksha. And this is, so in the beginning, the person deliberately cultivate it and then ultimately becomes a nature for the person. Now the qualities represented here by universal values are, they are once they are there and you gain a wisdom, then it is not like you know, it is not like a boat. Like boat is what you reach to the other, I mean you cross the river and reach to the, you know, the shore, then you leave the boat. Same way this characteristics are there, or let's say the values, basically you cultivate through effort and now you gain a wisdom, you become a wise person. So now you give up those values, etc. No, it has automatically become your nature. So we should keep this thing in mind. We may give up any other thing, but this will remain as our nature, and there will not be any effort, there will not be any conflict, and then you won't give it or give it up also. So now basically you interact with the world then spontaneously with all these qualities. It becomes natural to you. Now Bhagavan gives here two definition of a wise person, and because Arjuna has asked Sita Pragna se ka bhasha, so what is the description of a wise person? Then Bhagavan says these are Bhagavan defines Sita Pragna in two definition. He gives a two definition. First definition, now sarvan kaman manogatan prajahati yada, when he gives up all desire. Prajahati yada kaman sarvan, when he gives up all the desire, very very typical thing, he gives up all desire, means sthita prajna or a wise person has no desire. It is not like that. Manogatan, Bhagavan says that manogatan means which arise in his mind. So it means that desire, he does not pursue the desires because he gives up the desire. But you know, a wise person basically in his mind a desire which arises, that desire he gives up. That's what it means here. Question arises, if a man gives up or a person gives up his desire, then how will he have a happiness? Because without desire we don't find a person and the fulfilling the desire, of course. Without fulfilling the desire, person cannot be happy. So a man is happy only when he fulfills a desire, and so he gives up desire as they arise in the mind, and at the same time continues to live, because wise person lives. So then how is it possible? A desire arises in his mind, he gives it up, and yet he lives. Then he lives without happiness? No one can live without getting happiness. Person commits suicide means what? He feels that there is no ray of hope for getting happiness in the future. That's how people give it up, life, and therefore give up the life. And therefore, basically, this you know, the definition of sthita prajna does not make sense. Yada sarvan manogatan kaman prajahati tada sthita prajna uchyate. First definition, when he gives up desire and continue to exist in the world, then he has no way of being happy. Then definitely how can he live? That's itself is a question. So in order to answer this question, we have to take two things into consideration. First thing is, you see, the people are not happy. That is one thing, definitely, because when they fulfill the desire, then they become happy. Means what? People in general are not happy. That's the first consideration. And secondly, people are always busy fulfilling their desires in order to be happy. So they are always hopeful that happiness will come. And that's how, because they do become happy. Occasions come also. And therefore, with that hope, that the happiness will come in our life, they try to fulfill the desires. So two things that we have to see. The person is not a happy person by himself, herself. And secondly is, when he fulfills the desire, definitely he gets a object of happiness, he gets a moment of happiness, etc., etc. And therefore, People who pursue their desire are always working for happiness, whereas those who have given up the desires have no way of becoming happy or no way of being happy. So, and one cannot remain for a long period without being happy. That's also correct. So, Bhagavan, now this kind of a thinking, if we have, Bhagavan wants to correct it. That's all it means. Bhagavan wants to correct. This is a general observation which I have talked. Is a general observation in a human society. But Bhagavan wants to, correct this understanding of our, understanding of a desire, etc. That such a person is happy. For that he gives another definition. Atmani eva atmana tushta. He is happy. Don't worry. Atmani atmana tushtaha. Tushtaha is equal to, we have to take, he is happy, he is secure. Because both things go together. When you have insecurity, you cannot be happy person. And whenever you feel happy, you feel yourself secure also. Nothing to worry. And therefore, tushtaha is equal to one who is happy, one who is secure. Atmani eva atmana tushtaha. In himself or herself, the wise person is happy. Because the first definition created a problem that without fulfilling a desire, person cannot be happy. And basically all the people are unhappy and therefore they have a desire. In order to be happy, they fulfill the desire, they become happy. Now wise person gives up the desire arising in the mind and still he is living. How is it possible? He cannot live without being happy. Well, then Bhagavan says, Atmani Atmana Tushtaha. He is happy. His source of happiness is different compared to ordinary people. And therefore, don't worry. He is living and therefore he must be happy person. An unhappy person with no hope for happiness, he cannot live long. So, these two definitions go together. That's what I want to convey to you. And so basically, this Atmani eva Atmana tushtaha is the second definition of a wise person. In himself or herself, the wise person is happy. That's a translation. And now second point. Happiness is always centered on the self, right? Whatever the object is there. Suppose I am eating something, a sweet dish, which I really like, and then I become happy. Even though I eat a sweet dish and I have that kind of a thought that this is providing me a happiness, this is giving me happiness, yet I say the dish is happy, I never say. What I will say? I am happy. Right? That much we should say. And therefore, just as a wise person is happy by himself, everyone also is happy in oneself only, but always they say, I am happy because of something. That's all the difference is. This wise person says he is happy by himself. Ordinary person says he is happy by something else, because of something else. So nimitta to become happy is outside him. That's all it means. Whereas this wise person, without any external props and circumstances, without expecting, without depending upon anything, any condition, etc., this person is happy. And our analogy of that sugar crystal is very, very useful here. Simply by being a sugar crystal is sweet. So it does not require any sweetening agent to be sweet, because it is already saturated with sweetness, which is why it is called a sugar crystal. So it cannot be sweetened further. Similarly, one is happy, tushtaha, means it does not depend on any other object or situation to be happy. We have to understand, just like a sugar crystal does not require any sweetening agent, sugar crystal being itself is sweet. In fact, saturated with the sweetness. And same way, this jnani also, without depending on any other thing, etc., by being awakened to himself, his real self, his real nature, he is happy. What is that nature? Nature is happiness. Therefore, he is happy. So, sugar crystal is sweet. It doesn't require any sweetening agent. Because sugar crystal says, I am sweetness. Why you don't give me any kind of sweetness? Your sweetness does not, I won't count at all. Same with the happy, wise person also says the same thing. I am happy because my nature is fullness. I am full and complete. And therefore, just being awakened to his true nature, this person is happy. That's all the difference. So that is what the Atmani eva Atmana Tushtahe, in himself or herself, the wise person is happy. And Bhashyakara explains here, well, and such a person is called Sita Prajna, of course, Atmani eva Atmana Tushtahe. And well, Bhashyakara explains this is Sthitam. Sita Prajna means Sthitam is what? Well established. And well established in what? Prajna, he is well established in the knowledge, well, and knowledge of the Atma. And how does that knowledge arise? Bhashyakara says, Vivekajam. Vivekajam means Vivekat Jatam. Born of the Viveka. Born of Viveka. What kind of a Viveka? Born of the Viveka between Atma and Anatma. Just by identifying with the Anatma, the person feels unhappy. Yeah. Because Anatma is something limit, you know, means it is a limited. So identifying with a limited thing, he feels limitation. Even though he is not, he feels limitation. When he gives up the limitation in any state, I mean even in a waking state also, when he gets a moment of joy, he drops that limitation for a time being. Or in deep sleep, he becomes free from the limitation. When free from the limitation through, giving up the identification through to the upadhi, then definitely he finds himself limitless and therefore full. And that's how there is a joy also in deep sleep. So similarly, so basically his knowledge is such in which the limitation of the body, mind, sense complex, he does not impose upon himself. Well, limited body is limited, but he says, I am not limited. So that's a very great thing, because the limitation of this body, mind, sense complex, if you take it on yourself, then you are going to feel limited and going to feel unhappy also. So he has done this Atma and Atma Viveka, and through that there are two Vivekas we have seen. One is that Purushartha Viveka, which will be there before Karma Yoga. That's a different thing. Now he has gone through all this, and now he has definitely gained this knowledge also. And that here, which Viveka was useful? This Atman Atma Viveka. Two Vivekas are there, Nitya Nitya Vastu Viveka and Atman Atma Viveka. Nitya Nitya Vastu Viveka basically is even, that's a Purushartha Viveka. That is even before a person takes up a life of a Karma Yoga. But here, definitely after Karma Yoga has done its job, and the person has basically relatively free from Ragadvisha, etc., then he gains this knowledge. And through this Viveka called Atmanatma Viveka. So the one for whom this knowledge is well established is called the Prajna or Vidvan or a wise man. And Arjuna wanted to know this, Sita Prajna was, and this was Krishna's definition. So two definitions are there, both are connected. Please understand this, both definitions are connected. And very, very complete. I mean, it's a complete definition we can see. So, Sthita Prajna, Bhagavan says, is one who is being awake to the fact of that, to the true nature of the Atma, being happy for no other reason, gives up the desire that arises in one's mind. So, and then, now we'll have to discuss desire means what? Gives up desire means what? Because we don't find any wise person who gives up desire. In fact, they fulfill the desire. And therefore, now problem again has come. Description of a wise person means he gives up the desire arising in the mind. And Atmani Atmana Tushta. But we have not seen, not a Vyasacharya, not a Bhagavan Krishna, or not a Shankaracharya, not any teacher In fact, they work for the fulfillment of the desire. Then they all are otherwise then. If all are otherwise, then who has given knowledge to whom? If otherwise, if person is otherwise, he cannot give a wisdom, right? Wise person gives a wisdom. But wise person gives a wisdom, but then description of wise person is, well, basically he gives up the desire. The wise person has a desire itself to teach that person. And he pounds on him. Bhagavan did not allow Arjuna to speak in between, non-stop. Then he realized that I should allow the person to ask a question or something. And he has so many desires, my God. He has a desire of playing a ras with all these gopis, etc. And he has a desire of this and that and what not. Krishna is an embodiment of love. I say Krishna is an embodiment of desire. Then Krishna is not wise. Krishna is otherwise. Then otherwise cannot give the wisdom and cannot make the person, a listener, wise person. He will also make otherwise. So Vyasacharya ji, any project, if you take any project, if a bigger project is there, you may give up in between. Vyasacharya ji's projects are, my God, Mahabharata is 1 lakh verses, constant 1 lakh verses. And then he called this Ganapati also to write down, etc. And Ganapati says, my condition is I will not stop in between this. But Vyasacharya says, don't worry, not at all. You should not worry at all. One after the other, so many projects, all Ashtadasha Purana and then Brahma Sutras and what not. My God. And this Mahabharata, Abba, in which our Bhagavad Gita appears, Madhya Mahabharatam. So all wise people are Bhashyakara, my God, so span of 32 years, constantly all activity he has done. He was very active. Behind any activity, desire must be there. Without desire, there cannot be any activity. And all these people were highly active. They were so busy people and doing a lot of things. Then desire is there. Then Bhagavan says, desire, when desire is given up, arising in the mind, he becomes vice. But we have to see. What is this desire? Or Bhagavan talks about one kind of desire and this wise people had another kind of desire and that's how they fulfilled. Whatever it is, we'll see that tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.